This is going to be a video on synthetic biological circuits. I want to talk about the fundamentals of what synthetic biological circuits are, really. The very first time we thought of a biological circuit was with the discovery of the lac operon. So with E. coli, if they're presented with two different choices of sugars, if glucose is available, they'll actually turn off their lactose digesting machinery so that they can more efficiently eat the glucose and just wait until the glucose is depleted and then eat the lactose. From there, we've only got more and more sophisticated with our understanding of biological circuits. Everything that's alive is made up of computation. From the simplest bacterium to humans, we are doing computation all the time, where we're looking at our environment, we're sensing what's going on, and we are figuring out what to do next. We're all made up of loads of different little circuits going on to do the individual logical parts. Everything that happens is, in a sense, a biological circuit in some way, just made up of hundreds of parts. Plant, for instance, plants grow at night through something called the Calvin cycle. Whether or not they turn on the Calvin cycle in response to there being no light anymore, that's a biological circuit. On top of that, it can get more complex. Some plants will stop growing in the night if it's too hot, because it's basically inefficient for them to grow when it's that hot. And then even with humans, then we have loads of circuits going on all the time. Just going to bed, sleep is the result of a biological circuit. You've sensed that you've gone to sleep, now it's time to experience dreams. Those are all computational things. Those are all types of circuits that are similar to electrical circuits. We didn't use the same terminology as electrical engineering circuits until about the 1990s, where there's the first paper that was published that used electrical engineering diagrams to explain what was going on with a particular virus. Basically, the virus was deciding, do I attack this bacterium now and go and spread myself, or do I lay dormant for a while? And that used electrical circuit diagram. And then from there, we got more and more sophisticated again. So coming to the year 2000, the paper on the repressor and the toggle switch were published. And the repressor in particular is this amazing bit of research where the authors were able to take E. coli and make it fluoresce, and then it would stop fluorescing and it would just turn different colors over time, which is so cool. And that was a landmark, because that was the very first time that we as humans put together a biological circuit that does a new thing from scratch. Now that's super fun, but the repressor and the toggle switch only compose of a handful of genes. Natural biological circuits comprise of hundreds or even thousands of genes. To understand the complexity and why it's so difficult, I have to first tell you about how does a biological circuit work. In DNA, you've got the genes, and a gene will consist of, very broadly, the start, which is also called a promoter, the gene encoding region, usually it's for a protein, and then you've got like a stop. Don't make any more, because you're just gonna start making completely random amino acids. So you've got the gene. Once a gene is actually turned into the next instruction layer, that RNA goes to a ribosome, and by stitching together a bunch of amino acids, that folds into being the protein. But just those three parts introduce so much complexity into whether or not something will actually work. If you look at a biological circuit, even simple, well-characterized parts, when put together, can still completely deviate from what you expect it to do, which is in complete contrast to an electrical circuit, where if you have the modular parts and you organize them in the right way, as long as you've done your calculations correct, it will always do the same thing that it should. In biology, that's not the case. It's not just dependent on the organization, it's dependent on the context. That's like saying you want to put together a table and you try to screw in a screw, but then the screw goes, oh no, I'm in the wrong type of wood, the table is painted white, it's wet outside, now I'm just gonna melt. So the screw just melts. That's not useful at all. And that's basically what you're dealing with biological parts. Because there's so much going on inside a cell, it will not do as you expect. So the idea of synthetic biology then is to take all of these different moving parts and strip them down so that they aren't so complicated anymore. They're just the main thing that needs to do what you want it to. It's just the screw, it's not the heating element that melts the screw if something goes wrong. So that's a huge part of synthetic biology, is making circuits better. So a recent really cool example of designing new parts for biological circuits, there's a recent paper where they used machine learning to create a new type of promoter that would work in a plant and is much less dependent on the cellular context. Like, I'm a plant scientist, I love AI things, I'm always watching 2-minute papers. Synthetic biology and doing biological circuits, that's also my area of expertise. So seeing all of these come together, it's just fantastic. It's a really great time for science, and I'm really looking forward to seeing more stuff come out in the area. Like the comment. So if you like this video, comment down below what you think about biological circuits, what do you want to see next, and I'll see you for the next one. Bye. Now I'm gonna approach the camera. I'm going to turn it off.